we are looking at Dryden's essay of dramatic poesy. In the last class, we finished Lycidas's speech, and now we begin Neander's speech. So far, Crites, who represented the ancients, Eugenius, who represented the moderns, and Lycidas, who represented the Francophiles, or lovers of French literature. We have heard their speeches. Now, Neander stands for Dryden, and therefore we will have to look at his speech more attentively, as he would represent Dryden's point of view. I shall grant Lycidas without much dispute a great part of what is urged against us. So here the debate is between Lycidas and Neander on the question of the rivalry between the French and the English. So Lycidas supports the French, therefore he urged against the English. For acknowledge that the French contrived their plots more regularly and observed the laws of comedy and decorum of the stage, to speak generally with more exactness than the English. The French neoclassical dramatists, they observed the laws of the unities and the plot. They create the plot more regularly, that is, with less of subplots. Their plot is less complicated, their unity of action. Neander says that I grant that, I accept that. Further, I deny not what he has taxed us justly in some irregularities of ours, which he has mentioned. Yet after all, I am of opinion that neither our faults nor their virtues are considerable enough to place them above us. So he says, I also accept that our plays, English plays, have some irregularities. But still, I am not agreeable to accept that overall the French write better plays than the English. So you see how, because of this dialogue, this conversation, and also debate, that the essay becomes more interesting, it comes alive. Therefore, it is not an essay in the conventional sense of the term, where the author goes on rambling. Like Mauthen's essays, or even Bacon's essays, Charles Lamb's essays. So it is an essay of a very different type, where it is actually a dialogue presented through the essay form. For the lively imitation of nature being in the definition of a play, those which best fulfill that law ought to be esteemed superior to the others. It is true, those beauties of the French poetry are such as will raise perfection higher where it is, but are not sufficient to give it where it is not. So there is some criticism against French literature here, that the French plays or poetry in French plays, they are perhaps more perfect, more beautiful, but that beauty is the beauty of a statue or the beauty of a work of art. It is not natural beauty, unlike English poetry or drama. They are indeed the beauties of a statue but not of a man, because not animated with the soul of poesy, which is imitation of humor and passions. So there is a lack of passion, which is the soul of poetry. Why? Because French neoclassical drama was very restrained, controlled, unlike English drama, where there was a lot of passion. And this Lycidas himself or any other, however biased to their party, cannot but acknowledge. If you will either compare the humours of our comedies or the characters of our serious plays with theirs, he who will look upon theirs, which have been written till the last 10 years or thereabouts, will find it a hard matter to pick out two or three possible humours amongst them. So, Dryden, through the character Neander, says that in the plays produced in the last 10 years, if we look at the French plays produced in the last 10 years, and compared them to our comedies, which were mostly comedy of humor, or serious plays, meaning tragedies, where characterization is very important. In comedy, characters were mostly type characters. In tragedy, characterization is important. So Dryden says that it will be a hard matter. You see, Dryden using the article and before art, because age was believed to be silent under the French influence. In French it is always silent. When Dryden was writing, there was still the French influence on English language, and so age was believed to be silent, and that is why and comes before art. To pick out two or three possible humors amongst them. So the humors in French plays are not possible. It means they are not acceptable. They are not, you know, genuine. Corneille himself, the arts poet, what has he produced except The Liar? And you know how it was cried up in France. So Corneille, Pierre Corneille, the famous French neoclassical writer of tragedy and also of dramatic theory. So Neander says that his The Liar is one play which has good characters of humor. The Liar is possibly a comedy, but it was not accepted very well by the French themselves. So what else has he written worth comparing to English comedies? Corneille is the arch poet, the most famous dramatist. But when it came up on the English stage, the world translated, and that part of Dorant acted to so much advantage, as I am confident it never received in its own country. The most favorable to it would not put it in competition with many of Fletcher's or Ben Jonson's. So this play was translated in English and acted on English stage, and particularly the character Dorant, which Neander says that I am sure he was represented much better on English stage than in France. Even then, this play is nothing compared to the plays of Fletcher and Jonson. In the rest of Corneille's comedies, you have little humor. He tells you himself his way is first to show two lovers in good intelligence with each other. So this portion where Corneille talks about his method in comedy is a direct translation from his theory on drama. So Corneille there says that he shows two lovers in good intelligence with each other in the working of the play to embroil them by some mistake, and in the latter end to clear it and reconcile them. So this is the most simple possible plot in a comedy. The two lovers, how they have their affair, their relationship, and there are some complications, some hurdles, and how they are reconciled. Compared to that, the plays by Fletcher and Ben Jonson, they have much more complex plot. But of late years, Molière, the younger Corneille, Quineau, and some others have been imitating afar off the quick turns and graces of the English stage. So Neander says that recently the French dramatists have started imitating English plays, and the complex plot in these plays, where there are quick turns of the plot. Who are these dramatists? Corneille's brother, Philip Corneille, the younger Corneille is. So they were imitating English drama. They have mixed their serious plays with mirth, like our tragicomedies, since the death of Cardinal Richelieu, which Lycidas and many others, not observing, have commended that in them for a virtue which they themselves no longer practice. So after Cardinal Richelieu died, the French dramatists have started mixing humorous scenes in their tragedies. So, Nisidevus praised them for not writing tragicomedies or not mixing the genres, but he did not take notice that after the death of Cardinal Richelieu, who was the principal patron of French neoclassical drama, the dramatists have started imitating the English and mixing tragedy with humor. Most of their new plays are like some of ours, derived from the Spanish novels. The Spanish novels are the sources on which these plays are based. They discuss one of them without a veil and a trusty Diego, who trolls much after the rate of the Adventures. The Adventures was a play written by the English dramatist. So you can see that Diego is a Spanish character and he is a droll or a type character, like a servant, who is the source of much laughter and buffoonery. But their humors, if I may grace them with that name, are so thin-sown that never above one of them comes up in any play. I dare take upon me to find more variety of them in some play of Ben Jonson than in all theirs together. So the humor is very thin in French plays. In a single play by Ben Jonson, one can find all the humors combined in all French plays. As he who has seen The Alchemist, The Silent Woman, or Bartholomew Fair cannot but acknowledge with me. So these are the great plays written by Ben Jonson, great comedies, and Dryden naturally praises these plays. So when Dryden was writing the 16th and 17th century dramatists, the Jacobean dramatists, they were still the models. Ben Jonson, Shakespeare, Fletcher. I grant the French have performed what was possible on the groundwork of the Spanish plays. What was present before, they have made regular. But there is not above one good play to be read on all those plots. So the plots were taken from Spanish plays or Spanish novels. And I suppose Dryden is using the term novel in loose sense of story. But he is actually referring to Spanish plays. So the plots are taken from the Spanish plays. But the French make the plays more regular because they write following the neoclassical rules, the grammar of neoclassical plays. So their plays are more regular. But there is not one good play to read on all those plots. They are too much alike to please often, which we need not the experience of our own stage to justify. So these plays are very similar. Their plots are very similar, and therefore in English stage we do not want this kind of plays. As for their new way of mingling mirth with serious plot, I do not with Nisidevus condemn the thing, though I cannot approve their manner of doing it. So here is what Dryden has to say on tragicomedy, the new way of writing plays. He says that I do not accept Nisidevus' opinion that tragicomedies should be condemned, but I do not approve of the way it is written by the French. He tells us we cannot so speedily recollect ourselves after a scene of great passion and concernment as to pass to another of mirth and humor and to enjoy it with any relish. So Nisidevus says that one cannot very quickly pass from high passion and anxiety or terror to a scene of mirth and humor. But why should he imagine the soul of man more heavy than his senses? Does not the eye pass from an unpleasant object to a pleasant in a much shorter time than is required to this? So Neander says that this is an assumption that men won't be able to enjoy a comic scene after a tragic scene. Actually, it is possible. and does not the unpleasantness of the first commend the beauty of the latter? The old rule of logic might have convinced him that contraries when placed near set off each other. So Neander's point is that two things which are contrary to one another, they actually set off each other, or they appear to be in a better light when they are opposed against each other. And in logic at that time, contrary was an argument in logic. The continued gravity keeps the spirit too much bent. We must refresh it sometimes as we wait in a journey, that we may go on with greater ease. So too much gravity for a too long time would appear to be monotonous. So the mind should be refreshed with some humor. A scene of mirth mixed with tragedy has the same effect upon us which our music has betwixt the acts, which we find a relief to us from the best plots and language of the stage if the discourses have been long. So on English stage, where tragicomedies are not very common, Neander says that between two scenes of gravity we have music, and that provides us with some relief. And any discussion or any scene, any scene which has some debate or discussion, if the scene is too long, then it becomes difficult to bear. I must therefore have stronger arguments ere I am convinced that compassion and mirth in the same subject destroy each other, and in the meantime cannot but conclude to the honor of our nation that we have invented, increased and perfected a more pleasant way of writing for the stage than was ever known to the ancients or moderns of any nation, which is tragicomedy. So Neander says that, well, tragicomedy, I just said, was not very common in England, but I was referring to the genre of tragicomedy, where which was invented in Italy, and we find an example of this in Shakespeare's The Winter's Tale, where half of the play is tragic and half of the play is comic. That is, a play which begins as a tragedy ends with a comic resolution or a comic ending, which is not the same like many other English plays where tragedy has some scenes where there is the fool or the clown making some comic comments, as we have, say, in Shakespeare's King Lear, or in other plays, Macbeth. In Macbeth we do not have many comic situations, but in King Lear we have. So that is not a tragicomedy, but in this essay, the word tragicomedy is often being used in a loose sense. That is, wherever comic expressions or some situations are used simultaneously with a tragic scenario or a tragic plot. So this kind of tragicomedy was common in England, and Neander argues that, I would say that the English actually have perfected the tragicomedy and very easily mix comedy and serious scenes together. And this leads me to wonder why Lycidius and many others should cry up the barrenness of the French plots above the variety and copiousness of the English. So from this point, Neander goes on to argue that English plays are actually superior to French or any other plays. So he wonders why Lycidius and others, they create so much noise about the superiority of French plays over English plays, because English plays have much more variety and copiousness. Copiousness, that is fullness, Their plots are single, they carry on one design which is pushed forward by all the actors. In French plays, there is a single plot. Every scene in the play contributing and moving towards it. So everything contributes to the progress of the main action or the main plot. Our plays, besides the main design, have underplots or by-concernments of less considerable persons and intrigues which are carried on with the motion of the main plot. In English plays, on the other hand, we find main plot and a subplot. And the subplot is carried out by inferior characters. Very often we see that the aristocratic characters are the protagonists in the main plot, but in the subplot, the middle class characters, comic characters, as they say, the orb of the fixed stars and those of the planets, though they have motions of their own, are whirled about by the motion of the primum mobile in which they are contained. That similitude expresses much of the English state. So here Dryden compares the situation with Ptolemaic cosmos, where it was believed that the cosmos had a number of circles, concentric circles, one inside another. So the outermost circle was the primum mobile or the prime mover, and after that the circle of the fixed stars, and then the planets. So all these different circles were given motions by the prime mover. Similarly, in English stage, if contrary motions may be found in nature to agree, if a planet can go east and west at the same time, one way by virtue of its own motion, the other by the force of the first mover, it will not be difficult to imagine how the underplot, which is only different, not contrary to the great design, may naturally be conducted along with it. So, if in nature planets can move in different directions in the same orb, then why not in a play different plots that go in the same direction, the main plot and the subplot, they are not contradictory. The subplot actually reaffirms the themes of the main plot. So why can't they coexist in English play? Eugenius has already shown us from the confessions of the French poets that the unity of action is sufficiently preserved if all the imperfect actions of the play are conducing to the main design. So Eugenius, who represented the moderns, he has explained that there may be different actions in a play, but if all these actions serve the main plot, then they can be together. But when those petty intrigues of a play are so ill-ordered that they have no coherence with the other, I must grant that Lycidius has reason to tax that want of due connection. So if the main plot and the subplot, they are contradictory, and the subplot does not help the main plot, then Lycidius's criticism would be just. For coordination in a play is as dangerous and unnatural as in a state. In the meantime, he must acknowledge our variety, if well ordered, will afford a greater pleasure to the audience. So Neander says that coordination in a play, it is coordination between the main plot and the subplot, or the whole engineering of plots in a play, is a very difficult and risky task, unnatural task. Unnatural here means artistic, task, which is difficult. So as long as the plots are well ordered, Lycidius should acknowledge that English plays have a great variety. As for his other arguments, that by pursuing one single theme, they gain an advantage to express and work up the passions, I wish any example he could bring from them would make it good. For I confess their verses are to me the coldest I have ever read. So, Neander makes further criticism of French plays and says that even though Lycidius says that pursuing a single plot, the French plays become superior. I am not convinced, because he has to give me an example of a play which is superior to English plays because it has a single plot. And besides, their poetry is the coldest, which means that there is no expression of passion, there is no genuine expression of emotion in French plays, because these neoclassical plays, they are always so restrained, so controlled in expression. Neither indeed is it possible for them in the way they take so to express passion, as that the effects of it should appear in the concernment of an audience, their speeches being so many declamations which tire us with the length. So in French plays, the speeches, they cannot express the emotions or convey the emotions to the audience because their speeches are like declamations or long orations or long debates which tire the audience. The audience becomes tired and they lose their interest. So that instead of persuading us to grieve for their imaginary heroes, we are concerned for our own trouble as we are interior visits of bad company. So the audience, they are not persuaded that the heroes in the play, they have great trouble, because the audience feels that they themselves are in great trouble because they are in bad company. That is, the people are very boring and tiresome on the stage. We are in pain till they are gone. When the French stage came to be reformed by Cardinal Richelieu, those long harangues were introduced to comply with the gravity of a churchman. So Cardinal Richelieu was a religious man. So when he became all in all, he was the Prime Minister, he became the patron of the theatre in France. And then these long speeches, the word harangue is, it refers to a genre of sermons. So priests often delivered harangues or long sermons, which is full of some moral message as well as criticism of the conduct of the people. So these were very out of place in the theatre, but to satisfy Cardinal Richelieu, who was a churchman, these were imported. Look upon the Cinna and the Pompeii. They are not so properly called plays as long discourses of reason of state. A very famous plays by Corneille. These plays, Neander says, are more like long speeches. And polyuctic in matters of religion is as solemn as the long stops upon our organs. Polyuctic, another play by Corneille, is very solemn. And Neander says it is like the playing of the organ in our churches. Since that time, it is grown into a custom, and their actors speak by the hourglass, like our parsons. Parsons or priests, when they deliver sermons in the church, they used to set up an hourglass to measure time. So Neander says that the practice of the actors making long speeches may be compared to the English persons using the hourglass to make their long. May they account in the grace of their part and think themselves disparaged by the poet if they may not twice or thrice in a play entertain the audience with a speech of 100 lines. So this is sarcastically said, that the actors in French plays, they think that if an actor does not make a speech of 100 lines or more, two or three times in the course of the performance, then the audience is not properly entertained. I deny not, but this may suit well enough with the French, for as we, who are a more sullen people, come to be diverted at our plays, so they, who are of an airy and gay temper, come thither to make themselves more serious. So this may be all right with the French people, with the French audience, because they go to the theatre to become more serious. By nature they are jovial. But Danish people, they are by nature sullen, and they go to the theater to become more jovial, opposite of the French audience. And this I conceive to be one reason why comedies are more pleasing to us and tragedies to them. So French neoclassical drama was famous for the tragedies rather than the comedies. And English 17th century drama was more popular for its comedies. But to speak generally, it cannot be denied that short speeches and replies are more apt to move the passions and beget concernment in us than the other. So here Neander is referring to the repartees or witty responses in comedies. They are very pleasant. For it is unnatural for anyone in a gust of passion to speak long together, or for another in the same condition to suffer him without interruption. So long speeches by any actor is always unnatural. So anybody who is in a great passion won't speak at length. As for comedy, repartee is one of its chiefest graces. The greatest pleasure of the audience is a chase of wit kept up on both sides and swiftly managed. So quick replies or repartees are very popular in comedies. And this our forefathers, if not we, have had in Fletcher's plays to a much higher degree of perfection than the French poets can reasonably hope to reach. Such use of comic wit and repartee has been perfected in Fletcher's plays. So Neander says that the generation before us, they enjoyed such plays in Fletcher, if not we. There is another part of Isidorus' discourse in which he has rather excused our neighbors than commended them, that is for aiming only to make one person considerable in their place. So Neander is taking up all the arguments made by Isidorus, one after another, and Isidorus in his speech spoke of one character becoming important or more dominating in action in French plays, and Neander says that he has excused this rather than praised the French in this matter. So Lycidius kind of tolerates the fact that one character becomes more important rather than praising this fact. It is very true what he has urged, that one character in all plays, even without the poet's care, will have advantage of all the others. And that the design of the whole drama will chiefly depend on it. So it is very common in plays, it often happens that one character becomes more important and the whole plot revolves around one character. But this hinders not that there may be more shining characters in the play. But it does not mean that if one character is the protagonist or the hero, the other characters would not be also interested. So his point is that in English plays, there are many interesting characters. There is a lot of variety in characterization also, unlike French plays. Many persons of second magnitude, nay, some so very near, so almost equal to the first, that greatness may be opposed to greatness, and all the persons be made considerable, not only by their quality, but by their action. So sometimes there are characters who are equally great. Think of Antony and Cleopatra. There we have Mark Antony, Julius Caesar. Both characters are equally great. So in English plays we often have characters, more than one characters, who are great, so that they may be compared, Macbeth and Banquo, for example. So it is by their action that they are judged. It is evident that the more the persons are, the greater will be the variety of the plot. If then the parts are managed so regularly that the beauty of the whole be kept entire, and that the variety become not a perplexed and confused mass of accidents, you will find it infinitely pleasing to be led in a labyrinth of design, where you see some of your way before you, yet discern not the end till you arrive at it. So here Dryden is praising complex plots by saying that when there are more characters, when there is a complex plot, then you do not, then there is more variety, and you may not be able to see everything clearly immediately, but as the plot unfolds, you are like being led in a labyrinth where you cannot see everything on your own, but the dramatist helps you, leads you as if by the hand through the plot, and then when you arrive at the explanations that you are guessing, then you find joy, find a delight, and that all this is practicable. I can produce, for example, many of our English plays, as The Maid's Tragedy, The Alchemist, The Silent Woman. So, Maid's Tragedy by Beaumont and Fletcher, Alchemist and Silent Woman by Ben Jonson. These are examples of plays where there is a lot of variety and there is complex plot. I was going to have named the fox, but that the unity of design seems not exactly observed in it, for there have been two actions in the play. Now this is curious that Ben Jonson, who followed the neoclassical rules quite closely, The Alchemist is the best example of a neoclassical play. In Volpone, the comedy, he has a double plot. And the two plots run side by side. Thus, there are two actions in the same play. And it is not exactly very fortunate to have two different actions. So, Dryden stops from praising Volpone. So, he says that I am not naming it. Because of this weakness. The first naturally ending with the fourth act in Volpone the Fox. The first action ends in the fourth act. The second forced from it in the fifth, which yet is the less to be condemned in him, because the disguise of Volpone, though it suited not with his character as a crafty or covetous person, agreed well enough with that of a voluptuary. So, Volpone is a lustful character, and the disguise that he takes in that play is suitable to his character. And by it the poet gained the end at which he aimed, the punishment of vice and the reward of virtue, both which that disguise produced. So, ultimately, the plot has a unity of effect, because character Volpone is punished because of his vices. So there is poetic justice, reward for virtue and punishment for vice. So that to judge equally of it, it was an excellent fifth act, but not so naturally proceeding from the former. The fifth act in Volpone is a separate action, so that is the weakness of the play. But nevertheless, ultimately, the unity of the play is maintained, and the morals can be extracted from it. But to leave this and pass to the latter part of Lycidas's discourse, which concerns relations, that is, where there is not action but something is reported. I must acknowledge with him that the French have reason to hide that part of the action which would occasion too much tumult on the stage, and to choose rather to have it made known by narration to the audience. So we see that aspects of drama are taken up from three different points of view. So the features of neoclassical drama discussed both by Crates, Eugenius and Lycidius and Neander. So, Lycidius reported or spoke about the narrations, the relations, and then Neander also comments and he says that the French do well not to depict the violent scenes on the stage or too noisy scenes on the further. I think it is very convenient for the reasons he has given that all incredible actions were removed. So supernatural or incredible actions, they were mostly removed. But whether custom has so insinuated itself into our countrymen or nature has so formed them to fierceness, I know not. In English plays, unfortunately, these are not omitted. But they will scarcely suffer combats and other objects of horror to be taken from them. So the English native tradition of theatre dictated that quarrels, fights, battles, violent actions should be represented on the stage. And Neander says, I do not know why it is so in England, it is the custom. So there is a sense of kind of being apologetic here, that the French are much more civilized, they omit these things from being represented, but the English do not. And indeed, the indecency of tumults in all which can be objected against fighting. For why may not our imagination as well suffer itself to be deluded with the probability of it, as with any other thing in the play? So why should noisy fights be represented? Why can't the English audience also imagine such things to be happening? For my part, I can with as great ease persuade myself that the blows are given in good earnest as I can, that they who strike them are kings or princes or those persons which they represent. So he says that I can only imagine that the violent actions, the blows are given by the aristocratic people because that is convincing, that is according to social norms, and therefore that is acceptable. But does that always happen in English drama? In King Lear, I remember that there is a scene where a servant picks up or snatches the sword from the Duke of Cornwall and kills him, which is against the norms of society as well as the norms of drama. So even that rule is flouted by Shakespeare. So that is why Dryden is a kind of apologetic here, that it is things which are not acceptable. They are practiced in English drama. I would be satisfied from Lycidius whether we have any so removed from all appearance of truth as are those of Corneille and Romite. So here we have a criticism of Corneille's play and Romite for improbable scenes. A play which has been frequented the most of any he has read. If the Perseus or the son of an heathen god, the Pegasus and the monster were not capable to choke a strong belief, let him blame any representation of ours hereafter. So in Corneille's play we have this kind of action, supernatural action, or representation of monsters. So that goes against our belief or common experience. Therefore, Lycidius should not criticize English plays at all, where such absurdities are not represented. So here we find a criticism of Corneille's practice. Those indeed were objects of delight, yet the reason is the same as to the probability. So the audience may have delighted in those representations in Corneille, but still they were improbable. So when a dramatist represents something supernatural or improbable, then that goes against the vein of classical drama. For he makes it not a ballet or mask, but a play, which is to resemble truth. So in a mask or a ballet, that is where dance forms appear, there often supernatural things are represented. But a play is supposed to be very similar. It must resemble truth. And therefore, Corneille is criticized for not being very similar. But for death, that it ought not to be represented, I have besides the arguments alleged by Lysidius, the authority of Ben Jonson, who has forborne it in his tragedies. For both the death of Sejanus and Catiline are related. Neander agrees with Lysidius that death should not be represented on the stage. Somebody dying should not be represented because it is difficult and unconvincing. So he praises Ben Jonson for not representing death in both the tragedies Sejanus and Catiline, where the death of the protagonists are reported and not represented. Though in the latter I cannot but observe one irregularity of that great poet. He has removed the scene in the same act from Rome to Catiline's army and from thence again to Rome. So Neander criticizes Ben Jonson for removing the scene of action from Rome to Catiline's place and then again to Rome. And besides has allowed a very inconsiderable time after Catiline's speech for the striking of the battle and the return of Petreius, who is to relate the event of it to the Senate. The time gap in Catiline before the battle is over and the messenger comes back and reports it is considerable in Ben Jonson's Catiline, which I should not animadvert on him, who was otherwise a painful observer of tout prepond or the decorum of the stage, if he had not used extreme severity in his judgment on the incomparable Shakespeare for the same fault. So Dryden says that I would not have criticized Ben Jonson, a playwright who otherwise always maintains decorum. Tout prepond is the Greek for decorum on the stage. Decorum means following all the norms of classical drama regarding characterization, speech, and so on. So I would not have criticized him had he not criticized Shakespeare for the same faults. So here we see that Dryden is a little bit sympathetic to Shakespeare and being harsh on Ben Jonson. Because one who criticizes others should not make the same fault in his own writing. To conclude on the subject of relations, if we are to be blamed for showing too much of the action, the French are as faulty for discovering too little of it. So in English drama, we have too much of action and too little narration. On the other hand, in French drama, there is too much of narration and too little action. So both kinds of drama are to be criticized for this. A mean betwixt both should be observed by every judicious writer, so as the audience may neither be left unsatisfied by not seeing what is beautiful, or shocked by beholding what is either incredible or undeserved. So the playwright should strike a golden mean between action and narration, so that the audience is not deprived of seeing beautiful representation by too much of narration, nor he should be shown indecent things. So I'll stop here today. If you have any questions, you can ask.